Now we are going to talk about different conditions that lead to making a person more prone to overdosage reaction or less prone to overdosage reaction. These are called as predisposing factors. The factors that makes a person less or more prone to a specific disease or a reaction. Okay. Now these are classified into two. One is patient factor, the factors that are related to the patient, his own body. Second is the factors related to the drugs. The factors that are related to drugs, the pharmacology of the drug. First, we are going to talk about the patient factors. Now, the first factor is age of the patient. Now, remember this, a younger patient and an older patient, they both are more susceptible to a overdosage reaction. The chances of overdosage reaction occurring in a younger patient and an older patient is more. Whereas a normal, healthy adult individual, the chances of overdosage reaction are less. Why? In a younger patient, what happens is their bodily function, the liver function, the kidney function, they have not reached the optimum level. They are still growing. Okay. So they have not reached the optimum level. So they might show overdosage reaction even at a lower dosage because their body is not, they have not reached the optimum level of functioning. Whereas older individuals, their body function have deteriorated. Many of the old patients, they have diseases, hepatic failure, renal failure. Even if they don't have any failure, the chances are high that their bodily function, the function of liver and kidney, they have deteriorated with the age. So these younger patient and an older patient, they are at a higher risk of overdosage reaction. Then the second factor is the weight of the patient. Now by weight, I'm not talking about the total body weight of the patient. I'm talking about the lean body weight of the patient. In this person, you can clearly see he is full of fat. When you look for the weight of the patient, specifically in context of overdosage reaction, you're going to talk about lean body mass. So if a person is thin, he has less muscle mass. What happens is muscles, they'll have more blood. Now, less muscles, less blood, more muscles, more blood supply. It is same as adding a drop of ink in a 5 ml water and a 20 ml water. Which one will be darker? Of course, the 5 ml will be darker because the concentration is higher. Okay. It is same as that. A thinner individual is going to have less blood, whereas a bulkier individual is going to have more blood in the body. Suppose we give the same amount of drug. The chances are that it might cause overdosage reaction in this thinner individual, and that amount of LA molecules that cause overdosage reaction in this thinner individual, it will not cause overdosage reaction in this bulkier individual, because this guy, the bulkier individual, has more muscle mass, thereby he has more blood volume in his body, so he'll require more amount of LA molecules to cause overdosage reaction. Correct? Then presence of other drugs. Suppose if the patient is taking other medications, for example, meperidine, meperidine is a analgesic. For example, phenytoin is a antispasmodic. Cimetidine, it is for gastritis. These all drugs, they compete with the LA molecules for the binding proteins. So these drugs, they compete with LA, lignocaine. So they block the protein where these LA molecules are going to bind. So because of these drugs, these LA molecules, they are freely floating in the blood instead of being attached to a specific site. So gradually, because of the presence of these drugs already in the body, the dosage required to cause toxicity is less. Less amount of dose will cause toxic levels if the patient is already taking meperidine, phenytoin or cimetidine. Then, for example, disease. I've already talked about the age of the patient. Then we have disease. We've already talked about how renal failure or hepatic failure is going to cause increase in the chances of overdosage reaction. So that is the disease history of the patient. Then genetics. In case of amides, genetics play not much of a role, but in case of esters, genetics play a huge role because there's a genetic condition called as pseudoplasma cholinesterase. In that, the person is not able to biotransform esters properly, and that might lead to toxicity of ester molecules. Here we are talking about lidocaine, so genetics doesn't play a major role in LA toxicity, in lidocaine toxicity. Then we have the mental attitude of the patient. Now, mental attitude of the patient, suppose the patient is very apprehensive. Now, you give LA, the LA has worked perfectly. The LA has worked beautifully. For example, if you have given inferior upper nerve block, you can see that there is numbness of the lip. You have given the lingual nerve block, you see that there is a numbness of the tip of the tongue. But when you try to, suppose you are extracting a tooth, when you try to apply a pressure over the tooth, the patient jumps in the seat, in the dental chair, because he is not able to differentiate between the pain and pressure. Okay. What you might feel is that the LA has not acted properly. Then you give more amount of LA, you repeat the block, you start the procedure again the patient jumps in the dental chair because of the pressure, he is not able to differentiate between the pressure and the pain, you give more LA. The chances are, because of the apprehension of the patient, because of the patient jumping in the dental chair, as he is not able to differentiate between the pressure and pain, you end up giving more and more LA to the patient, and that might lead to toxicity. Now we come to the drug factors. In drug factor, first is the vasoactivity. Vasoactivity means what is the effect of that drug on the vessel walls, whether it causes the vasoconstriction or it causes the vasodilation. Now LA molecules, amides, by themselves they cause vasodilation. What happens is, if we give local anesthesia specifically at a site, by themselves they are going to cause vasodilation, that causes increase in blood supply of that site, and because of that there is increase in uptake of the local anesthesia drug. Okay, so local anesthetic drug by themselves, they cause vasodilation and the absorption is at a faster rate. Okay, so that is going to lead to the drug achieving the toxic levels at a faster rate. The chances of LA overdosage are increased when LA is used without the addition of a vasoconstrictor. Then we have the concentration. We have different concentration of local anesthesia available, lidocaine, 0.5%, 1% and 2%. Now, suppose we are going to compare the 1% lidocaine and 2% lidocaine. Okay, so 1 ml of 1% lidocaine is going to contain half the number of molecules that are present in the 2% lidocaine. If we give 1% lidocaine, the amount of ml required to achieve local anesthesia overdosage is going to be more, whereas the amount of volume required to achieve local anesthesia overdosage will be less. So overdosage reaction incidences increase with the increase in concentration of the drug. Then we come to the dosage. Suppose we have a 2% lignocaine drug and we are injecting that patient, but we administer the patient almost 30 ml. Of course the patient is going to experience the overdosage reaction. So every ml is going to add up and increase the mg also. Okay, the dosage, the more the dosage that you give to the patient, that is going to lead to the more chances of overdosage reaction. Route of administration, that is important actually. Intraorally, what happens is, we give local anesthesia in the blocks like inferior alveolar nerve block, PSA nerve block, infraorbital nerve block. The problem with head and neck region is that the blood supply of head and neck region is excellent. It is excellent. So when the blood supply of a region is good, the uptake of the drug from that site is also very good. So when we give LA in our head and neck region, the absorption is at a faster rate, whereas as compared to the same drug deposited, same LA deposited in the hand or leg. Okay, because the blood supply of head and neck region is excellent. Okay, that is one thing. Second, suppose we deposit LA directly in the muscle, as we talked about earlier. When we deposit the LA directly in the muscle, the blood supply of muscle is also high, so the uptake will be higher. So the LA molecules are added into the bloodstream at a faster rate, and that might lead to overdosage reaction. Then the last route of administration that we are going to talk about is the intravenous, or directly into the vessel. That is one of the reason we aspirate in two planes. Okay, so to prevent intravascular administration, if you deposit LA directly into the blood vessel, so suddenly there's a spike. Within a few seconds you'll see the symptoms. Okay, it will reach toxic levels in the blood within a few seconds, 15 to 30 seconds it will reach the toxic levels if you deposit the LA directly in the blood vessel. Intraorally, blood supply is high, absorption is at a faster rate. If you deposit LA in the muscle, again the blood supply is high in the muscle, so absorption is at a faster rate. You have to remember one thing, we always try not to deposit LA in a muscle, because LA in itself, they are myotoxic. they cause chemical injury to muscle fibers. So that might lead to myospasm, spasm of the muscles. Okay, that is one of the reason we see trismus after inferior alveolar nerve block. Okay, one reason for trismus after inferior alveolar nerve block is multiple needle punctures. Second is deposition of LA directly in the muscle, that will lead to trismus. And the last one that we talked about is intravascular injection of LA. Then rate of injection. Oh, this is important. Ideal rate of injection is 2 ml per minute. You have to go so slow that you deposit 2 ml of 2% lignocaine in 1 minute. So suppose even if you are inside the blood vessel, you are depositing LA at such a low rate, it is not spiking suddenly to the toxic level. You are adding the LA at a very gradual rate. Another advantage of rate of injection is that when we deposit LA, you deposit LA at a slow rate. There is no pressure application at the adjacent structures. If you suddenly deposit the LA, tissues like this, suddenly there is something, some LA deposition, there is pressure in the surrounding tissue, patient will experience pain. If you deposit LA at a low rate, what happens is there is less pain, and intravascularly if you are there and you deposit LA at a lower rate, what happens is the chances are that you might prevent toxicity of local anesthesia even when you have deposited intravascularly. That is why biplanar aspiration is important, and that is why deposition rate of 2 ml per minute is important. Now, vascularity of the site, as I told you earlier, vascularity, blood supply of the site is high, that will lead to a faster absorption of the LA from the site, and that will lead to the chances of increased overdosage reaction. Okay, so vascularity. Then the presence or absence of vasoconstrictor. We've already talked about this point in the vasoactivity point. What happens is LA molecules by themselves, they cause vasodilation, that causes rapid absorption of the LA molecules into the blood. Okay, presence of vasoconstrictor, what they do, epinephrine, what they do is they cause vasoconstriction. So the rate at which the LA molecules are added into the blood, it is reduced. So it delays the increase in LA molecules concentration in the blood. So it prevents LA toxicity. Just by presence of vasoconstrictor, LA toxicity can be prevented.